First of all, of course, I wanted to say again thank you very much to the organizers for the opportunity to be in this very nice workshop, in this fabulous location. It's a pleasure to work here and to go to the beach as well. What I will be talking about now, as compared to the school, is I will move up from 3 to 4 dimensions. It will be all classical GR. But nevertheless, you will see Schwarzian derivatives, how they arise in a very natural way in four-dimensional GR. Which is kind of exciting because it means that you can see Schwarzian derivatives in the sky if you want. Some extrapolation, of course, but it is even true to some extent. Most of what I will be talking about is based on work done with Cédric Troussard, and so I will give you in 20 to 30 minutes a quick overview, of the results without any technical derivations. We did a bit of technical derivations in the school. And I will give you what I was aiming for. So what I really was aiming for in four-dimensional GR was the analog of the Brown-Lenau classical central extension. Can you find C is equal to 3L over 2G in four-dimensional GR? And you will see that you can, but you have to invest quite a lot to get it. And then, for the remainder of the time, we maybe can focus on one or the other more technical questions if you're interested in them. That's what I'm going to show. So, this. How should I say? I recently learned during a conference at King's College, so there was a conference about this BMS formalism, and they were trying, there were a couple of talks where people explained why this BMS formalism was so important in general relativity. And the reason is that it helped to settle a controversy whether gravitational waves are actually physical in full general relativity. So of course, you all know that in linearized GR, there's absolutely no difference between gravity waves and, there's little difference between waves in linearized GR and electromagnetic waves. The kinematics is a bit different, but still everything is clear. But in full general relativity, it was not so clear whether gravitational waves actually existed. And there was a controversy involving Einstein, which makes it, of course, more interesting. And if you if you want to read about this, there is this, first of all, the book and also the contribution by Kenefic to this conference, where he really explained this controversy, why it was a controversy and how it was resolved. And then also, there's a very nice review paper, Scholapedia of 2016 by Medline and Vinicourt, where they review the Bondi-Sachs formalism and how you can see also the gravitational waves in this context. So it's a very small review, and it's quite nice. So the point is that the Bondi mass loss convinced people that gravitational waves actually existed, because it says that if you have an isolated system that emits gravitational waves, it loses its mass, and that this is a nonlinear effect in general relativity. So you don't need to do linearized GR. You see it in full GR, but you have to do something at infinity, a kind of expansion, and you see that the system, when it emits gravitational waves, it loses some of its mass through this emission. And that helped somehow convince people that it was a real physical effect, and not a gauge artifact or something. So the setup that one is going to study is the following. One imagines that one is at null infinity, and one studies what happens to the system when one moves up in a retarded time. So this is this retarded time we saw in the lectures in school. You are at null infinity in four dimensions, and Scry in that case is, let's say, the sphere times a line. And you study what happens when you evolve the system and you take you go forward in this retarded time. For some of the effects that are related to conformal field theory that I want to show, it's of course then very useful. this was done very early as well, to introduce complex coordinates on the sphere that you have, on the celestial sphere that you have sitting there, just by using stereographic projection. So the metric of the sphere you can write as a metric like in conformal field theory, so it's conformally flat, and this is the conformal factor, and you see it explicitly when you use this stereographic projection. So these nice pictures, of course they are really beautiful, they are from Penrose, and you can find them. Rindler, he has this amazing ability to draw in one dimension more than you can draw. So, it's very nice picture. And then, as I also told in the school, there is this quite remarkable, very early paper in 1962, which tells you everything you need to know about asymptotic symmetries for this system. First of all, the concept of asymptotic symmetries was introduced, and then very early on, it was shown that if you do the most natural generalization of symmetries in this gravitational system, so meaning what I have shown you, the infinitesimal diffeomorphisms or the diffeomorphisms that keep your gauge fixing conditions and your fall-off conditions in place, you find, people found that the group is in fact bigger than the Poincaré group. So it's not just a standard Poincaré group, but it's a larger group. It contains super translations. People were not very happy with that. They wanted to find ordinary Poincaré. And maybe because of that, this paper has not drawn so much attention. Because they really wanted something else. And then they spent a lot of time trying to put the different conditions on the system to reduce the symmetry group back to Poincaré. But it turned out that when you try to do that, you lose what you want to study, which is the gravitational waves. So if you restrict, if you put additional conditions on your system which are coherent, then somehow you don't have the waves anymore that you want to study. So that was the point. So that's why this BMS group, of course, it's well known ever since then, but it, people did not really do so much. So the question is, how much bigger is your group than the Poincaré? And basically there are two options. So the standard GR choice, which is of course perfectly well motivated, is to have everything, because you are interested in smooth solutions, you don't want singularities, so you want everything to be globally well defined in your spacetime, and also globally well defined at scribe. When you ask for that, you have to ask, what are the transformations that keep so first of all, locally geometric ansatz in place, but that are also globally well-defined. If you ask for that, then it turns out that the Lorentz generators become the globally well-defined killing vectors, conformal killing vectors of the celestial sphere, and your group is enhanced by an abelian factor with a semi-direct product, which is exactly the same that you have for the Poincaré group or for the Poincaré algebra, except that instead of ordinary translations, you have super translations, meaning functions which have an arbitrary dependence on theta and phi, but still globally well defined in theta and phi, meaning that you can expand them in spherical harmonics. So you have SL2C acting on globally well defined functions of the sphere. So that's the BMS group as it was studied in this paper by Sachs in a very, very clear way. If you only need one to read one paper, that's the paper to read. The rest you can forget. But then, of course, after CFT, it's also clear that maybe you're not so interested in having globally well-defined things, and maybe having all the local solutions to the conformal killing equation is good enough to, or is interesting to get more physics out of it. So that's exactly the same step like CFT, and if you do that, it means that in terms of this zeta and zeta bar coordinates, you expand your generators in Laurent series instead of in globally well-defined. So if you do that, then instead of this version of the BMS algebra, you find two copies of the Witt algebra which are commuting, and if you want to invent a name, you can call them superrotations because they generalize the standard rotation and the hyperbolic rotations. And also the super translations change because you expand them no longer in spherical harmonics, but in terms of fields which have certain laws. You adapt the modes to the transformation laws, and you find that you, if you do this Laurent type series expansion, you have formulas which you could have found in CFT textbooks, which tells you that this is a certain field of a certain weight. And of course, what is nice is that the Poincaré superalgebra sits is just the lowest modes of all these modes here in this big algebra. So you would not recognize it immediately, but that's exactly what it is.
Then you can,
yes?
Just a question, just to remind. In the Brown and Noe case, they were also allowing for singular killing vectors?
Very good. Now, in that case, it's not necessary, because everything is just Fourier transform on the circle, and everything is globally well-defined. So this question about poles or not does not exist in three dimensions. In three dimensions, this enhancement is there without having to say something about singular things or not. It's just there. I mean, and also in the BMS3 case that I have been showing, everything is Fourier transforms on the circle.
So you have all the modes, positive and negative.
In any case, you have. Yeah. Here, you have an enhancement by supertranslations, but depending on if you are local or global, it is different things. And both are good objects to study, right? I mean, for different reasons and involving different solutions. So what you have to understand, and what people understood later, is that if you play this kind of games, it means also that you will have to admit solutions which have poles as singularities for consistency, because you act on solutions, and even if you don't have them, you will generate them.
Yeah.
You see? And, so, but if you only want regular solutions to play with, then you have to stick to this case. But still, what I'm going to say will have something to say about that. It's just what topology are you putting in on top of your local things. Yes?
So the Poincaré subalgebra is two copies of global conformal transformations?
Yes. No, two copies plus, in a semi-direct way, acting on these four generators here, which represent the four translations, how you see them at SCRA, how you see them up at null. And if you do the counting, that's good. I mean, six is good for Lorentz. So from that point of view, you're happy. And then the algebra also is the case, not in the usual basis, but of course it is good. Very good. And then, of course, as we also saw in the school, the construction of, so once you have symmetries, you would like to have the associated conserved charges. You would like to use some version of Noether theorem to build conserved charges. Of course, conserved charges in GR is a kind of a tricky business in some sense, because it precisely involves gauge symmetries, and then you have to do a bit something else than you do for the standard Noether theorem. It's not just the standard formula. But in any case, let me not get into this. When the dust settles, you end up with an expression which is for the conserved charges, and well, for what you think are the good conserved charges, and there is a constructive procedure. And if you build, so there's two issues here. First of all, I'm not doing the integration of the charges, because if my generators have poles on the sphere, and I want to integrate these objects on the sphere, if I use these superrotations with poles, the integral over the sphere will produce infinity in some sense, because of the poles that you have. But of course, you know also from your conformal field theory textbooks, when you do word identities, you can do the integrated word identities, but you can also do the local version. And the local version, so instead of doing the integral of the charge to get the number out, you do the current algebra. You don't integrate, and you allow your objects to have poles. And you can study these poles. You're interested in those. So that's something you can do. So this is the time component of the charge that, in the globally well-defined case, you would integrate over the sphere at infinity, over the celestial sphere. And it would be, in the Hamiltonian formulation, the generator of the transformation. And you work it out, and what is interesting is, so you see that each of these, you can also work out the spatial components. It's a bit of work, but it can be done. And The structure is that you have one of the symmetry generators folded again with part of the solution. So if you remember what we had in three dimensions we had the generators and a linear part of the solution. Here you see that you get the generators, you get the linear part, and these psi's, I should say, are just leading components of the wild tensor, so you should not be afraid. It's just some parts of your solutions. It can also be completely given in terms of the metric, if you want, in terms of these sub leading components of the metric that I had put on the blackboard in the school. It's the same thing. You can use either a formulation on shell, it's the same thing. You have the leading part of the wild tensor, which comes in, which is the linear part, which is exactly the same part that we had in three dimensions. But you have another part, which has to do with the asymptotic part of the shear and the news. So this sigma zero, just to give it a name, but it's not really important, is the asymptotic part of the shear, and the time derivative of that is the news. And you can relate it to the subleading components of the metric, and you can understand that it has to do with the transverse traceless polarizations of gravity waves. So the contribution to the gravity waves, the nonlinear contributions that people were happy to find is in here, and the linear contribution, which gives, for instance, the mass of the Kerr black hole and the angular momentum of the Kerr black hole, is in this linear part here, the same part that we had in three dimensions. So you see that this 1 over r expansion at infinity gives you both topological, the three-dimensional, the same information you had in three, plus the information on gravity waves, which is there. And in this Medler paper, Medler and Winnicott, they really show how in the Bondi Metzner-Sachs formalism, not exactly this, but the subleading parts of the metric contain this information on the on the polarization. To go back to linearized gravity and see how this can be. So you really see these two parts, and for instance, the Bondi mass would be the integral of this object if you take for this just one, because f is basically super translations if you switch off the super notations, and f is equal to one is the generator which takes you up in retarded time. Okay? So the Bondi mass is just the integral over this bit plus its complex conjugate, with this guy being one. Okay, that's the point. And that's also something we had seen in the school already. Now you have these asymptotic symmetries, you know that they transform solutions to solutions, and you can work out how they act on solutions. So, because you know that, well, when you do this computation, you find that from the CFT point of view, and now it's kind of CFT, you have a two-dimensional, two plus one-dimensional kind of CFT, if you want. You have the time U, but you have also zeta and zeta bar. It's the news, this sigma dot, which is the closest to an energy momentum tensor. Okay, so the news transforms is a field of weight 2,0, if you want, with an object here that would be if. So maybe let me also explain what f is. So this f is just the standard complex derivative if p was equal to 1. So if the conformal factor here would be equal to 1, then f just turns into the standard complex derivative. But of course you have to correct by that. If your p is not exactly equal to 1, but it's the one for the sphere, it is just, maybe you could do it with background charges or things like that, but it's exactly what you have when you move from the Riemann sphere to the unit sphere. So you have to do something to your conformal field theory, and you have to correct by the covariant derivatives which come from there, and this is very nicely included in this Newman-Penrose formalism, which is this F. But you can think of this as just the complex derivative. And then you see from here, because this psi here is really the conformal factor, and it would be just the standard conformal factor if you are if p is equal to 1. This becomes the third order derivative of one of the generators for superpositions. So exactly the same formula that we had in three dimensions in this group. The one which was discussed a lot in the gravity literature was actually the transformation of the asymptotic part of the shear, and it goes with x squared of the supertranslation generally. And what you can see from this formula, what I also try to say in the school, is that there are these inhomogeneous transformations. You see that fields have certain weights, but they also have inhomogeneous transformations. And you see that, for instance, the Poincaré vacuum, so Poincaré space, which you can identify as being sigma 0 equal to 0, sigma dot 0 equal to 0, no gravity waves, also this psi is all being 0. So you see that the Poincaré vacuum breaks BMS symmetry. And then there was, there was all the work by Strominger who said that this should be interpreted as saying that there are Goldstone bosons associated to that and one should study them. But, okay, so in some sense you can see it from this transformation. What we have been doing is to try to work out the current algebra. Okay, I mean, in this kind of effective theories, one thing that you can do, you have built this current, and so what you can do is you take the current associated to some symmetry generator and you act with the transformation of the other symmetry on the current. This you can do because here it says how the currents, how the symmetries act on the fields, and so the symmetries will act on this object, and then you expect this from general theory to give you the current with the commutator of the symmetries. This you can expect from the Hamiltonian formalism, for instance. There's different reasons to do, different ways to do current algebras. So this is what you expect. And also this term is also fine because in terms of the currents, if you would integrate it, this is a boundary term, so it says that the charges form a representation of the symmetry algebra up to the spatial boundary terms which are always there. So that's fine, that's what you expect from first principles. But when you do really the computation, you find two types of breaking. First, you find this breaking here on the left-hand side, and when you write it down, you see that it is really related to the news, to the gravity waves. So it will not be there if you study, let's say, the Kerr spacetime or something like that. And you find another breaking, which vanishes because it has this third-order derivative of the conformal factor. I mean, because this psi has another derivative, it will vanish if you do not admit superrotation. If there are no superrotations and you only have globally well-defined things, this object is not there. In that case, and let us now for the moment suppose that we are not interested in superrotations, so this object is not there, and try to see what this formula here tells you, if it really is understandable. Are you able to understand, then in that case, this breaking here? So, to understand this breaking, so one thing that you can do is, if you choose for one of the symmetry generators, you choose the symmetry you're interested in, and for the other one, you choose the retarded time translation generator, your current algebra formula becomes, in fact, the left-hand side here. So you shuffle this bit to the other side, and you read what it gives you. It tells you by how much the currents are not conserved. This is a conservation equation. It says that the time derivative of this thing, this is a spatial derivative, so if you integrate over the sphere, these are boundary terms. If everything is globally well-defined, you integrate over the spheres, these are boundary terms, and this thing goes away, this thing goes away, and you only stay with this object here. Suppose no superrotation, so we just stay with this object here, and we see by how much the BMS charges, or if you want, the BMS air in the modern language, you see, by how much this object here is not conserved. And then you do the next thing, you choose for the other generator also Xi is equal to, Xi1 is equal to d over d mu, and then the charge, as I have told you, gives you the Bondi mass. So this equation here then tells you by how much the Bondi mass is not conserved. You stick everything in, you find that when you move up in retarded time, you only have mass loss because this thing here is positive definite. So you see that you recover the thing that we started from the discussion. So this is the thing that was already known to bond this. This mass loss formula that when you move up in retardy time, your bonding mass, you lose it. So you can see that this current algebra is just a generalization of this bonding mass loss formula. So you would expect it to have some, maybe some significance. Any questions on that?
So
yes.
You won't say that this body mass is decreasing because of the emission of gravitational wave?
Yes.
And which time should I identify the gravitational wave?
The sigma and the sigma dot is in Bondi's first paper he says this sigma dot here is the whole. If the system doesn't have sigma dot or sigma, it doesn't emit gravitational waves. And if you do it in this Bondi-Sachs formalism, you see that sigma is related to the subleading part of the angular metric that I have shown. It's also, it can be related to the polarization of the gravity. It's just a different characterization. So sigma dot being zero would say no gravitational waves, no mass loss through scrap. Okay, the term, of course, I'm interested in, that's more because I was trying to find the analog of this Brown-Hinault central charge. So the term I'm interested in is this term, actually. So this breaking we now understand. It tells you how you lose BMS here when you evolve the system. So this contains this information. So what about this term here? So this term is only interesting when you are interested in superrotations. It's only there in that case. That's the one that I want to study. And every time you have such an equation, so you have delta acting on something, gives something, you know that you have this type of Vesomino consistency conditions that you can meet. You can hit this with another delta and then do some cyclic permutation and see what the right-hand side has to satisfy. That's one computation that one can do. Then you find that this has to satisfy a co-cycle condition, which is very similar to all types of co-cycle conditions that you find in quantum field theory. Okay, you have your effective action, you act with a symmetry on the effective action, you get the breaking, and the breaking, because you act with a symmetry, you act twice, and you take commutators, has to satisfy some consistency conditions. And it's the same thing for this object. And of course, every time there is such an unexpected term, sometimes it can teach you something about the system. So as I said in the school, there's the central extension by Bachmann in the Galilei algebra. There is the central extension in the Witt algebra when you quantize the theory, or when you do ADS3 gravity, a classical central extension or quantum central extension. And sometimes these unexpected numbers teach you something. In this case, the object, technically, is very close to, at least the consistency condition it satisfies, is extremely close to the consistency condition satisfied by chiral anomalies in quantum field. So chiral anomalies satisfies this Adler-Bardeen-Vesomino consistency condition, and when you have done the quantum field theory and you're only interested in the some formal aspects of the gauge theory, it turns out that the Adler-Bardeen anomaly can be understood as an element that is in the descent, which relates the trace of F cubed, so the characteristic class, to the primitive element here. They are related by a descent equation. And in this descent equation, the Adler-Bardeen anomaly sits here, and the integral over over space-time of this object tells you is the Adler-Bardeen anomaly which sits here. So this is the type of consistency condition it satisfies. And you can do out of this central object that I have here, that you just get when you compute, in this case, you can build a similar object, you can build a two-form, which is, so this K mu has exactly the indices to build this two-form. And then you can check that if you promote your symmetry generators to fermionic variables And this is just a technical thing, a technical Bereste thing, which allows you to formulate the consistency condition in this way as a causality condition. So you upgrade your symmetry generators to fermionic fields, and then you find that the consistency condition satisfies by this breaking is exactly of this type. So you have gamma acting on this object up to D of something with some descent equation. It is contrary. So central extensions are well known from Lie algebras. So in Lie algebras, people who have studied this, a central extension has a formulation where, if you look in textbooks, it says that a central extension in a Lie algebra is controlled by the second cohomology class of the Lie algebra. It's H2 of G that you have to copy. But in some cases, you have objects. So for instance, if you study gauge theories, which are a bit richer than just Langmuir's theories, you can have structure functions instead of structure constants. So for instance, on shell in some supersymmetric gauge theories, when you take the commutator of two gauge transformations, they close to a gauge transformation on shell, but the structure constants that you would have in Young-Mills theory become structure functions in the sense that they depend on the fields of the theory itself. If you have this kind of structure, mathematically you call it an algebroid instead of a Lie algebra. It turns out that the Jacobi identity, because you have structure functions, getting modified. So this would be the Jacobi identity if you have structure functions, if you have structure constants, but if you have structure functions, this is the modifications that you. So, and then if you have a Lie algebra over functions, so instead you have your generators here with structure functions here, you can take elements that depend on the fields. Then, in order to have a good Lie bracket, the structure that you're going to have is the following, which is exactly what we saw in the lecture in the school. So you have to correct the bracket as this type of terms, but you have to correct for the dependence of the xis on the field, which acts like that. So you have a correction. That's exactly what we saw in the asymptotic symmetry vectors. There was a dependence on the metric that you have to take into account. And in fact, you can show that gauge theories are generically like that. If you change, you can change generating sets, for instance, in a gauge theory. And for instance, when you go from the Hamiltonian to the Lagrangian description, what you do in this description is that you change generating set and you allow the fields of your theory to enter your fields. And this is precisely this type of modification. Then you can study central extensions in this context. So central extensions in this context is something you say, I have my generators, my commutator of my generators, it involves field-dependent structure constants, but then the central extension can also be field-dependent to be consistent. If you do that, you find that the consistency condition satisfies by this object here is precisely of the same type that I have shown. So the consistency condition, so the H2 in the Lie algebroid is exactly what you find for this object here. So an extended object is an extended Lie algebroid would be something like that, where this two cocycle, which depends on the field, satisfies a consistency condition, which is exactly the stuff that I have shown. In order for this to work, you need all spatial boundary terms to vanish, because otherwise your objects are not going, it's not going to work. So in order for this to happen in our context, you can no longer integrate over the sphere as you did before, because you had these poles, but what you have to do is, you have to do separate contour integrals in this zeta and zeta bar, because only then can you get a consistent mathematical structure. So you change the way how you evaluate integrals if you allow for poles. You take contour integrals instead of taking an integral over the sphere, which would diverge. And if you do that, then you can do all these standard expansions that you know from this vertex operator algebra. So you can expand everything according to its conformal dimension. So which weight you have to put here when you do an expansion in zeta and zeta bar is basically determined by the numbers you can read off from here. This is how you expand fields in this context. And when you do that, you find that now you get well-defined formulas for this, for the central extensions, but the central extension depends on the modes of some fields of your theory. So the best one, and probably the one that's most relevant for gravity, is the one like in three dimensions between super-rotations and super-translations. And you see that you have the standard kind of formula, m times m squared minus 1, but instead of having a number which multiplies it, you have a mode of the asymptotic part of the shear which goes with this equation. Okay, it's an interesting structure. I think people more or less know these structures in conformal field theory, but this is how it appears. So if you are willing to do that, you are going to get these numbers, and these numbers then are the analog in four-dimensional gravity of the Brown-Eno central charge. You see that you have to do a bit more, but it goes along the same way.
Excuse me.
Yes.
So do you have singularity, ambiguities in this double integral? If you have poles, then I guess if you change the contours, you...
Absolutely, but then you have to say what kind of series you allow for, what is the dual spaces and what kind of series you allow. So, for instance, what you're going to say is that the generators you're going to expand in terms of Laurent polynomials, and then the solutions can be series. You see, you have to say what the space is and what its dual is. But all this is relatively well understood in the mathematical conformal field theory literature about vertex operator algebra. So you can look at these books which put more emphasis on that, and they tell you what you can use as duals.
There, I know very well the story in CFT, not very well here, but in CFT, I think there's never an ambiguity because the contour depends on how you insert operators in correlation functions, etc., etc.
I think it's fine. You have this double series. It doesn't need to be holomorphic. You can have Z and Z bars, and you can have this. This is exactly the framework in which you have to play. Okay, this is a relatively recent thing, so I don't know how much people have played in this in gravity, but for sure in CFT they have done all kinds of things with that.
But in CFT I understand, because the singularities in CFT come from OPEs.
Good.
So you have, you know, correlation functions, yes. And it's well known in not only in CFT, in any quantum field theory, that when two points coincide there will be a singularity, and when you have CFT, the singularity needs to be special, as is governed by conformal invariants, and that's where you get the singularity. So there are no more local singularities in quantum field theory. Here, it's different.
No, it's different. It's a kind of classical version of that.
But where are your insertions?
My insertion, I will show you. The insertion for this to be correct is, you don't, sky is no longer a sphere, but you have two, you have a vertex operator sitting at the singularity, really,
okay.
Where your poles are, in some sense.
So it's like you put some source there.
Exactly. That's exactly what you do. And what you're doing is how your classical solutions respond when you put sources there. And the formalism that you can... Well, this will tell you how solutions change, not how correlation functions change, but how classical solutions in the bulk will change when you put some sources on sky. That's probably one way to interpret. That's not what people usually have done, because people wanted sky to be smooth, and they were not really interested in having sky an arbitrary Riemann surface or something. But this tells you that just from transformation formula, you don't need to do the computation of the solution again. You can get, if you have the solution in some topology from the transformation law, you can build the solution how it looks like when you change the. I think that's what it could be used for. I mean, it's like when you know, when you have computed the t on the plane, you get it on the cylinder, just from a transformation, and without having to quantize the system again, right?
Yeah.
Same thing. Okay, but then you are a bit disappointed because you would like to do, even though you don't maybe understand it completely, you would like to do curve CFT or the derivation of the entropy from the Cardy formula by sticking this number in the Cardy formula. But then you look at your thing and you see, ah, but for the curve black hole, this central extension that I have worked so hard to compute is actually zero. So you're not very happy because you thought you had something to sell, in a sense. But of course, this is true if Sky is really the sphere. But now that you have these transformation laws, you can integrate them to finite transformations and look how your asymptotic part of the shear changes when you do a finite transformation instead of doing an infinitesimal transformation. So what happens to the sigma, which is zero for curve, when you map the celestial sphere, or when you map the Riemann sphere to a cylinder by the standard transformation? And then you get, of course, from this transformation laws, the standard kind of finite shifts that you get. So this thing which is zero when Sky is the Riemann sphere, with punctures or whatever, is no longer zero when it is the cylinder. That's the interesting thing. So you have a number, and maybe you can do something with this number to explain something. This is relatively recent, but at least there's a lot of things to play with, I would say, which have somehow the right flavor. So, any questions on that part?
I'm just confused. You are looking at, for instance, some black hole solution, then look at this asymptotic infinity.
Yes.
Now, what does it mean physically to have central extension of this symmetry?
Okay, very good. Then you should ask the same question. What does it mean in ADS3, gravity, to have the Brown-Hinault classical central extension? So there is exactly this is the four-dimensional version of a three-dimensional classical ADS3 computation. And there you find, by exactly the same methods that I have been showing, a classical central extension that you can use to plug in into the Cardy formula, and it gives you, when you plug it in the Cardy formula, it gives you the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy of the BTC. It doesn't mean that you have understood the CFT that is really underlying it, but it tells you something. It's a classical number that is interesting to some extent. That is an interesting number.
Okay. But there you have holography that explains it all.
But I would say, what are you saying? That you need really ADS3 cross S7 to really know?
We know that from holography you can link the CFT on the boundary to some bulk theory, and we know that then the CFT central charge computed with the holographic rules will match the Brown-Hinault central charge computed classically in the ways it did long ago. So this is fully understood there. Here you don't have a similar thing, so it's a completely different. I don't think it's fair to say it's the same.
No, the classical part for sure is the same. The classical computation is the same than the Brown-Hinault computation.
Yeah, but the physical interpretation.
Okay. So maybe there's some part then missing from that perspective, but I am also not completely sure how much the other, or at least, let me put it like that, I have not completely understood the other quantum computation that you were talking about.
No, this is completely clear. So you have holographic, for example, you can compute the two-point function of the stress energy tensor. As is well known in CFT, this yields immediately the central charge. So you can compute this two-point function using the holographic dictionary. It gives this central charge. And then you can relate with full rigor this number to the Brown-Hinault computation and the Brown-Hinault central charge. So
which paper? Exactly. Does it
I can tell you. Okay. This is a basic thing that is.
No, it's an important thing, I agree.
This is a standard calculation.
To me, at least, okay. Of course, that's not my main expertise, but if people have really identified, completed the CFT, and can say it is this CFT which gives classical central charge, 3L over 2G, like that, I would like to see it. I would like that people tell me this is Vesomino-Witten theory.
That's not what I'm saying.
Okay, my question is, do you know what is the microscopic theory, the microscopic degrees of freedom that give rise to exactly this classification.
But that's not what I was talking about. That,
okay,
okay, we can talk.
This is not the point. I agree, it's an interesting question. And there is much more in that respect. That's absolutely true. But the other thing,
I don't understand the holography point of view from, you know, that goes to scribe. So you need to have a theory defined on scribe. This is very mysterious to me.
That is why it is very good to do the three-dimensional toy model for that, in which you have analog, the same kind of things, which is very close to ADS3, CFT2 from a formal point of view, but in which it is much easier to relate to ADS3, CFT2, because you can take a flat limit and you can see how these results change.
So that's what you explained in the
story. Yeah, exactly, and that's where lots of people have pushed in some sense. What I'm, the part of the, I'm only talking about one part of the story, which is the classical gravitational part.
Yeah.
But I'm saying this part you can repeat. And that, I think, is equations. There's not, interpretation and deeper understanding is to be done. But the equations in itself and the result in itself, okay, I think there is a point on trying to make it. That's what's done.
If you were to start with ADS4 and try to take flat space limit.
Very good. As I have shown, I have just shown you the symmetry computation. And you see, you will, the symmetry computation that I have sketched in the school, under the standard fall-off conditions, there is a jump in the solution. So the equations are completely, let's say, when you take L going to infinity, the equations are not singular. But the solutions are completely singular. In one case, you get super translations. In the other case, you don't get super translations. So with some choice of fall-off conditions. But nowadays, people have found other fall-off conditions in which, I don't know if it has done in full generality, in which you could hope for that you find also, let's say, this kind of things also in the ADS4 context. But the usual, the standard boundary conditions give you in ADS4 just SO32. Nothing, no infinite dimensional enhancement, no smooth limit, so you have to do something.
What is the criteria and how do you decide what fall-off conditions should you choose?
That is, the fall-off conditions that you choose determine how much boundary theory you are going to find. It's, for the moment, at least for me, it's essentially consistency conditions, if you can define conserved charges in a way, in a serious way, these kind of things. But for instance, in three-dimensional gravity, if you choose very reasonable boundary conditions, you find nothing, because you will not excite these solutions. You find very little, and that's what people had in the before Brown-Enow, for instance, for ADS3, they had very small symmetry groups and very small solution spaces. The more you relax your boundary conditions, and so boundary conditions are part of the definition of your theory. It's, I don't think they completely follow from just the equations.
So I have a question about this. If you cannot answer short, we talk later. But because that's a very interesting point. I mean, that's something that confuses a lot of people. So why cannot you do that this way? So you start from flat space as nothing, okay?
Yes.
And so you have a time slice and you evolve. And then at some point you allow that in the bulk, you can turn on some stress energy tensor. Maybe it has to satisfy some energy conditions that are technical things. But let's say you turn on some general stress energy tensor at some point. And so this will create some gravitational waves and eventually the gravitational field the non-trivial gravitational field will appear, and then the system evolves, and then you see what it yields at infinity. Isn't that the way, the physical way you would say, okay, this has to be, then the boundary conditions has to be the one that will allow for an arbitrary bulk stress energy tensor to generate gravity through the Einstein equation? Let me
try to translate how it was done. So maybe a good paper to go back to see how it was done, which could be very close to what you were saying, is this Bondi-Sachs papers in the beginning. They were studying known solutions in linearized theory, and from that they inferred reasonable fall-off conditions in some sense. That's what they were doing. Similarly, for instance, when you look at all these Brown-Henault, Henault-Teitelbaum studies of ADS asymptotically ADS spacetimes, the way they were defining Fall-off conditions is they were taking the background, which was anti-de Sitter space, flat space, and then they were taking one interesting solution in this class, like, for instance, the Schwarzschild anti-de Sitter black hole. And then they were saying, ah, I want to generate a solution space, so I want to act with the killing vectors of the background on this solution to generate a kind of self-consistent phase space, fall-off solutions, which by construction will have as asymptotic symmetries already the isometries of the background. When they do that in four dimensions, and then they look, well, they generate some fall-off conditions, and they look what leaves that invariant. When they do that for anti-de Sitter space in four dimensions, they find SO32. When they did exactly the same thing in three dimensions, they found they started off with SO22 to generate the fall-off conditions, and then they were studying again what leaves it invariant, and then they found that the conformal ones were unkillable in some sense. Right? So it is, in my opinion, closing what you are suggesting, but then of course there's much more geometric ways to define what you mean by asymptotically flat or asymptotically something, which people in the GR literature have spent a lot of effort. But I don't think that the rules of the game are completely fixed to some extent. There is still some playing out, I bet. Does it answer to some extent?
Yeah, thank you.
Very good. Now for this finishes the general part. How much time do I have?
So 9 minutes about.
Very good. That is perfect. So I will maybe just say a word about finite BMS transformations to conclude. So I've shown you the Lie algebra transformations, but of course in gravity it's interesting to have the group, how the group acts. And the problem that you have to face is how to integrate your transformations from the infinitesimal one to the finite ones. And there's a very cute exercise that you can do, which is in ADS3 gravity. You take this solution space that we have seen, and so this solution space that we have seen in the lecture, and you ask, what are the finite coordinate transformations, but finite coordinate transformations that leave this ADS3 solutions invariant? And this is in fact a way to get the Schwarzian derivative from a holographic computation, from a bulk computation. So you don't need to integrate it like in Di Francesco, but you get it from just asking what finite coordinate transformation leave this metric invariant, this three-dimensional metric invariant, you generate the Schwarzian derivative. You can play the same game here. This is all the stuff that I have shown you in the school, so let me not, there is also wild transformations in the story, let me maybe go quickly over that. And maybe let me just show you our best results. So this was what we have already seen. How to do the current algebras. The nice thing is you can also do wild transformations on top of that, so you're much closer to the symmetries. You can also make this P move. Instead of having it one, you can just move it in some sense. So that's wild transformation. Then you see Robinson-Trautmann waves, so that's kind of nice. So here are the finite transformations that you, for instance, this one, you're not really surprised. I mean, you get it from this bulk computation and you find that where there was the third order derivative, you get the Schwarzian derivative, of course, here, in this zeta prime thing. And you find that the asymptotic part of the shear also has this kind of Schwarzian derivative. But probably our best formula is the formula for how the Bondi mass transforms under finite BMS transformation. So you see that if you work it out, so you recall that the Bondi mass was the coefficient of the time translation generator. And you try to understand how it changes under a finite supertranslation and a finite superrotation. You can compute that. I mean, in the same way that you can do the infinitesimal computation, you can do this computation. So why could it be interesting? For instance, you open this paper by Hawking and co-workers on that they have written in this context, and they say, ah, the Bondi mass does not change under supertranslation. Can you see that from this formula? And the answer is yes, because the Bondi mass is the integral of this object, over the sphere, if you want. And you see that if you're only doing super translations and not super rotations, all these Schwarzian derivatives here, even this double Schwarzian derivative that we are very proud of having computed, all this stuff drops, and you only remain with that. The transformation of the Bondi mass is a double derivative of this type of double derivative of the supertranslation generator, or the finite supertranslation. So you see that the integral of the Bondi mass does not change. But you can also see how the Bondi mass changes under ordinary rotations, like under Lorentz rotations, but also under super rotations. So all that you can dig out from the formalism. Of course, we were quite happy because we found these formulas and they must mean something. And then we were saying that nobody in four-dimensional GR had done Schwarzian derivatives before, and since Schwarzian derivatives is the theme of the conference to some extent. Of course, we were not the first one, because there has been a very interesting, well, there has been, you know, in this kind of subject, everything is done, but there were papers by Penrose and Nutku, where really they were studying gravitational waves, but with singularities, with exactly this kind of via singularities, these poles that we have been talking about. And they had a geometric construction for them. When they were constructing them, you see exactly the same type of metrics with Schwarzian derivatives here. So even though maybe things have not been done in complete generality, these formulas with Schwarzian derivatives and the solutions for which they are relevant are known to some extent. So you see that this is not just going off in a completely strange direction, but it ties in with things that have been done in the gravity literature before, for a long time, in fact. This is 72 or something. OK, very good. Let me maybe stop here.
Okay. There's been a number of questions already, but I think we can take one or two quick ones.
This last case was a two-dimensional case, I didn't quite understand.
This is this solution,
yeah.
4D GR.
If this is 4D, then we have
both psi and psi. You see the method du dv,
right.
D zeta and d
zeta,
zeta
bar. So
you remember I had u and r, but this is u and v. And the thing is to start off from, really, a bit like you were saying, from Minkowski, and then do a finite transformation to generate something. But of course, they have also an interpretation of what kind of solution this represents. And it is solutions with some kind of... okay, let me not say more. This is, of course, very hard to find. So I think Sibudoya found this paper because it's in a Twister newsletter. And maybe you have not read all the Twister newsletters. Also, you see Psi 4, exactly like this. So,
any other questions? If not, let's thank Glenn again. And let me back at the